Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, I have come down from heaven? And Jesus answered them, do not complain among yourselves. No one can come to me unless drawn by the Father who sent me. And I will raise that person up on the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father, except the one who is from God. He has seen the Father. Very truly I tell you, whoever believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread that comes down from heaven so that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. Whoever eats of this bread will live forever, and the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. And this is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Brothers and sisters in Christ, grace to you and peace. From God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, who says, I am the bread of life. And the psalmist who says, taste and see that the Lord is good. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So the first time I saw this sanctuary, and I saw the wall behind me, I'm thinking, yep, there's the I am statements, and we're five short. You ever notice that? In the Gospel of St. John, there are seven I am statements, and it's important for you to realize that when Jesus says, I am, he is claiming he is God. He is making a claim of divinity. And he starts out in chapter 6 with, I am the bread of life. Later on, he'll say that he is the light of the world, and the next time he'll say he's the door for the sheep. Then he'll say he's the good shepherd. And then he will say, I am the life. And he says that to Martha when her brother's been dead and buried for 4 days. And she is heartbroken because she had expected him to come in time to heal her brother. He healed everybody else. And he said, I am the resurrection and the life. And then on the night that she was betrayed, he told his followers, let not your heart be troubled, believe in God, believe in me, for I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then he said, I am the vine, you are the branches, without me you can do nothing. Which tells me that the converse would be that with me, you can do everything. But today we're going to focus on, I am the bread of life. And I think about bread. I think about bread a lot. I miss bread. But bread was the one thing most people could afford. If you remember the story of the widow and Zarephath, she had just enough flour and oil to make what she called a cake, but it was basically a flat bread. Every society on this planet has some form of flatbread. In the United States, most of the time, it's tortillas. Unless you're Norwegian, then you get some lassa thrown in at Christmas. But a flatbread, not in India, and there was none in Tanzania, and it was just a flatbread. And most likely, that's what Jesus was talking about when he talked about bread. It was just this bread that would sustain you and nourish you and keep you from starvation. And Jesus said, I am the bread of life, and in my body, my flesh is life. And that's a hard concept to swallow, literally. Because we think about it when we talk about in Holy Communion, I say it every time. This is my body given for you. And when Jesus says, unless you eat you have a dog, and the dog gets a bone and is gnawing at it. That's what Jesus is literally saying. And at the time he said all that, he had a lot of people following him. Oh my goodness, he was a big time Charlie. He was healing people, he was raising people from the dead, he was feeding people with meager resources, and they thought he was literally walked on water. And then he said, oh, by the way, if you want to follow me, you need to eat my flesh. And most people turned away. The Acts of the Apostles records that on the day Jesus ascended, his followers were all there. They numbered 120. Well, in the winter months, fall and winter months, that's less people than we have here on Sunday morning. So can you imagine that hard teachings are hard teachings? And yet the psalmist proclaimed a good 1,000 years before Jesus, taste and see that the Lord is good. And Jesus talked about yeast, so I know that they used wild yeast to make a sourdough kind of bread. He talked about leavening agents and things like that. And what doesn't smell wonderful but walking in to your house or as you're baking bread and that smell? Have you ever noticed that in most grocery stores, it's produce at the bakery first? Why? Because it's beautiful and it smells good. And then what happens? You start getting hungry. And why are the carts so dumb? Because you think you need to fill them up. And Jesus says, if you come to me, you will never be hungry and you will never be thirsty. Because I am the bread of life. And he says, come to me, taste and see that I am good, and that you will have abundant life in Jesus Christ. So it's kind of an interesting thing. One of the reasons for this week and next week, and then I'm gone for a weekend, and then I'm back, and for 5 weeks, we're going to do the I Am statements that are up on those banners. We're going to kind of fulfill all the I Am statements of John, because this is the gospel year of Mark. And in Mark, year, we do 5 weeks of John 6. And I'm going to talk about Jesus being the bread of life once, not five times. So I thought, we'll do a sermon series. A lot of pastors do that in the summer of the year of Mark. But Jesus being the bread of life. And I always think about how, what are we hungry for? What are we hungry for? And I don't mean food. I think everybody here has enough to eat. If you don't come see me, because we got beans and cucumbers and zucchini. Corn's coming, isn't it? About another 2 weeks. Potatoes are coming. Yeah, we've got food. And we give generously to the food banks. There's food. That's not the kind of hunger Jesus is talking about, though. Jesus has gone from, give us this day our daily bread, to what hole in your soul needs to be filled? And what are you using to fill it instead of Jesus? Because you will never be satisfied. I saw a meme go around on Facebook that I really agreed with that said, it isn't that we don't have enough to feed the poor. We don't have enough to satisfy the rich. And I think that has some bearing on life in general, that the very rich just don't seem to be happy with what they have. I saw that perfectly explained to me anyway, one time, and I don't like this show, but I was watching it because I had nothing else to watch. You know how those go? And too lazy to find the remote. I mean, how sad is that? I used to be my parents' remote. You know? Don't change the channel. You know? Which of the three do you want? But anyway, I'm watching Deal or No Deal. And this woman picks a suitcase. And she hangs with it. And she gets through all the wheeling and dealing. And it's down to two suitcases. And she says, no, I'm sticking with this one. And they opened it up and it was $3 million. of you would be really happy if somebody handed you a suitcase with $3 million. Yeah. I'm already spending it in my head. We put the other IM statements up there. And a few other things. But then they opened the second suitcase. And there was $8 million in that other suitcase. And you look at her face, and she is disappointed and mad. I said, yeah, the rich are never satisfied. And Jesus speaks to that hole in our soul. What do you fill it up with? What activities do you fill your soul up with as you're dancing away from the Creator of the universe? What never quite gets you filled? What activity just messes with you? Casinos literally gamble on you having a hole in your soul. When I lived in Sacramento, you could, for $15, this was 30 years ago, I don't know what it is now, but $15, you could ride a nice Windstar-type bus from Sacramento to Lake Tahoe, and when you got there, they'd give you $12 in cash, a roll of quarters and a roll of nickels, and a voucher for the buffet. Right? So I would leave my money at home, because I knew better, and I'd maybe take 10 or 20 bucks with me. When that money was gone, I'd eat the meal, get on the bus, and go back. So you're driving through the Sierra Mountains, the Sierra foothills, it's a beautiful drive, and you're having some fun. And I always observed people that had paint, just playing like I was, and it was fun, and when your money was gone, it was gone, because something has to pay for the overhead of that building. They're in business. People that have businesses are in it to make a living, you know? I'm always surprised when people think products should be given away. That just doesn't work. Last I checked, that just does not work. And I would get on the bus and I'd go home. Now, fast forward 10 years and I've met my third and last husband. And I met his uncle Orlo, who I just adored. And I told him about how I do that, because he said he goes to Ottawa on the bus, state deal. And I said, yeah, I used to do that in Lake Tahoe, da-da-da. And he says, yeah, I get there, they give me the money, and I walk around, I put it in my pocket, and I walk around and watch everybody else. Never occurred to me to do that.
Saves, and then, you know, Wilbur finds out that usually
they did was with an apple in their mouth on a platter. And so he's understandably worried about this. I would be worried if I knew I was about to have an apple in their mouth on a platter. I'm grateful for pigs for giving their life. You know the old saying, in any situation, the head is involved, but the pig is committed. Eat for your breakfast of eggs and bacon. And so he meets a spider named Charlotte. And Charlotte goes about saving Wilbur. And first, she weaves a web that says, some pig. And instead of everybody going, wow, what an amazing spider, they're all like, well, some pig. It's a pretty good pig. It's amazing what we can call something, and people go, oh, yeah, that's really good. That's a wonderful pig. Ignoring who was doing the blessing of weaving some pig in her form. And then she put Hummel. And then her piece de resistance was radiant. That Wilbur was radiant. And I want you all to think of a pig being radiant. And in the eyes of Charlotte, Wilbur was radiant, and he was some pig. And Charlotte went with him to the state fair, where she laid her eggs, and she died. And I think of E.B. White, who was an interesting man, who wrote interesting things, and there's always layers and layers and layers. And if you pay attention,